Hello, and welcome to Israel Palestine, Will It Ever End? My name is Peter Larson, and I'm the chair of a small Canadian NGO called Canada Talks Israel Palestine. This is the third in a series of six lectures delivered at Carleton University in the spring of 2017 on the complex Israel-Palestine issue. This lecture is called The History of Antisemitism in Western Europe, Zionism, and the Creation of the State of Israel. This lecture is unusual because it features a special guest lecturer, Mr. Richard Marceau. Mr. Marceau is a Canadian Zionist, and he is senior legal counsel for the Center for Israel and Jewish Affairs, Canada's most important pro-Israel lobby group. I invited Mr. Marceau to give the lecture because I felt it was important for Canadians to hear the perspective of a Canadian Zionist on these sensitive issues. I don't share Mr. Marceau's point of view, but I think it's important for everyone to understand the perspective. I'm grateful to him for his collaboration. The six lectures can be viewed independently. You don't have to see them in any particular order. To learn more about Canada Talks Israel-Palestine, please visit our website at www.canadatalksisraelpalestine.ca or visit our Facebook of the same name. If you have any comments or suggestions directed to me, please feel free to write me at chair.ctip, Canada Talks Israel Palestine, so at chair.ctip@gmail.com. Thanks very much and happy watching.
This is in Hebrew. It's in the imperative form. It's pronounced zachor, which means remember. That is a commandment that is part of the Jewish culture, the Jewish religion, the Jewish idea. Remember. Yes, it's similar to Quebec. Je me souviens. There's actually some, you know, it's funny you say that. It's similar to Quebec. You know, when I speak to Quebec audiences, I say, you know, the Quebec flag and the Israeli flags are both black, blue and white. Both flags were adopted in 1948. If you go to Israel, you see the piece of one shekel, which is the money. There's a fleur-de-lis on it. And when I got married, my wife, who was Jewish by birth, said to her doctor, well, you know, I don't need to take the taste. You know, the Ashkenazi Jewish, so Jews from Eastern European have a high potential of developing a disease called Tay-Sachs. If a child born with it usually would die within 4 years. So she said, I don't need to do the Tay-Sachs test because my husband is not Jewish, or the probabilities of him carrying the Tay-Sachs gene is very low. And he said, well, you know, what's the origin of your husband's French-Canadian? I said, yeah, well, he has to take the test. You have to take the test because the group with the second highest proportion of Tay-Sachs is French-Canadian. So maybe French-Canadians are a lost tribe. But that's another. So the importance of Zachor, to remember. And this, to understand Jews or Judaism or Jewishness, you have to know that the duty to remember is hardwire in our brain. Shabbat, remember the Shabbat. You would read the Bible, remember the Shabbat. Remember what God did to this person or that person. So it's, if you read the Bible, meaning in my case, the what you call the Old Testament, there's that duty to remember. And the memory is very, very important in Jewish tradition. So for example, the most celebrated holiday in Judaism by Jews, either religious or not religious, is Passover. This is where families get together, have that big dinner, and spend a lot of time. And you will see, when you read the Agada, which is the book that you read around the table during the Seder, the dinner during Pesach, Passover, is that each person must see himself or herself as he or she personally experienced the Exodus from Egypt. So for Jews, history is not something that's in the past only. It's something that has to be lived now. It is with us all the time. If you walk around Jewish areas during the fall, for example, you will see people building those little booths. They're called sukkah. And that's to remember the exit from Egypt. And the sukkah, the sukkot, it's plural, have to be built a certain way, and they have to be not too solid. And the roof, you have to be able to see through the roof to see the stars, because the Israelites that left Egypt needed to build something quickly and move on. So to remember always, and you, and that it carries into the present. In traditional Jewish communities, in August usually this they mark Tisha B'Av, which is the destruction of the temple, and people will fast, people will refrain from marital relationships, people will sit on the floor and mourn the destruction of the temple that happened in 70 CE. So history for Jews is not only something in the past, but is something that is with us as well. And that that applies to, of course, history. The history of pagan anti-Semitism, Christian anti-Semitism, the persecutions, the expulsions, the forced conversions, the pogroms, the crusades, Muslim anti-Semitism, the Nazis, the Shoah, communists. So it creates a lasting national memory. It is with Jews all the time. So to understand Jews, you have to know that. Even again, I say that, and it's important, even Jews who are not practicing, even Jews who are not observant, this is important to understand. Very quickly, just want to go to explain what is Judaism or Jewishness, and I try to I understand it's not a course of religion, but very, very quickly, this is, quote unquote, our Trinity. God or the Torah, the Bible, the peoplehood, and the land of Israel. And Jewish identity is based on those three things. And the importance will vary according to each person. So somebody can be actually totally non-observant, don't believe in God, doesn't believe in God, but believes that there's a Jewish people, there's a Jewish nation. Or then again, the centrality of the land of Israel is very important, including again for Jews who are non-observant. So to understand Jewishness in one slide, this is it. And if we think that we can take away the national part of Judaism and understand Jewishness or the Jewish community, you've got it wrong. And Judaism is very different from Christianity. It's closely linked to a national identity. In the Bible, when you read again the Torah, the Old Testament, Jews are not a religion. The word religion, or its equivalent in Hebrew, does not appear anywhere. Jews are a people. If you read Genesis, and I will make you a great nation, and I bless you and make your name great, and you be a blessing. It doesn't say, I'm going to make you a great religion, a great religious community. I will make you a great people. So if you don't understand the national aspect of Judaism, there's no understanding of the Jews or of the Jewish state. I said earlier, today's most beloved by believers and not believers alike, ceremony in Judaism is the Seder of the Passover, which ends next year in Jerusalem. We end that highlight of the Jewish calendar, the most beloved ceremony, which happens in the house, not in a synagogue, in the house, that's next year in Jerusalem. So that connection to Jerusalem, that connection to the land of Israel is very, very important. And if you don't understand not only the national aspect of Judaism, but the fact that it's linked to a specific piece of land, there's no understanding of the Jews, of the Jewish state. Questions so far? Important to put things in perspective. When we speak about Israel, we speak about that little piece of land here. 22,000 square kilometers. Goes into Canada 42 times or thereabouts. It's tiny. It is tiny. You can drive from Eilat here to the border of Lebanon, by the time it takes you to drive from here to, let's say, London, Ontario. At its smallest waist here, it's 15 kilometers. And when I want to talk about it, it's pre-1967 borders, right? And you probably touched upon the... So it's 15 kilometers. So from where I am here to go to my house in Elmer, it's farther than crossing the entire country. So the importance of putting things in perspective is very, very important. Zionism. So, modern Zionism is born in 1987, but the national attachment to a specific piece of land is timeless. So basically what I'm saying is that Zionism is the modern movement or the modern iteration of the Jewish connection to that piece of land. It's a product of a homeless people that kept the dream alive for millennia, from 70 CE to 1897, which is the foundation of the State of Israel. This is not unimportant. Yesterday I had a meeting at my synagogue, and when I go, the meeting was at 6:30. I went to 6 to help people do a proper Jewish prayer service, you need 10 people. So when I have a meeting, I go before, so to make sure that 10 people at the synagogue. And we were praying after a day of rain for rain to fall, because the prayer was obviously not for Ottawa, because even the prayer for that is linked to what happens in Israel. Zionism is restoring the Jewish people to the cultural richness as a nation has when it lives in its ancestral homeland, speaks its own language, and develops its own culture. It is about going from subjects of history to actors in history, and it's about self-determination and a means of self-respect. And it's very interesting to note that Zionism was born and carried, certainly at the beginning, by secular Jews. That people who decided to let go of the religious aspects of Judaism to focus on the national aspect of Judaism. Theodor Herzl was the founder of modern Zionism, was a secular Jew. He had a Christmas tree in his house, because that meant acceptation of the general culture around him. The first prime minister of Israel, David Ben-Gurion, was totally non-believer. He said in his adult life he went to synagogue twice. And that tension of what it means to be a Jew is still with us today. It's very hard to say, what's a Jew? Is it a question of belief? Is it a question of practice? Is it a question of belonging? How do you define what is being Jewish? Yes.
Celebrate Passover?
Yes, absolutely. And most, actually, it's the most celebrated holiday of Jews. Most Jews would go to synagogue 3 times a year. Just briefly as a background, they will go for Rosh Hashanah, the Jewish New Year. It's 2 days. They will go for Yom Kippur, and that's it. But they would have every Seder, they would go for Pesach, they would find a place to go. The context of Zionism. It's the context of the Enlightenment. And it's a rebellion against Judaism of old in many ways. Judaism and Zionism is a European phenomena. It was a rebellion against the traditional Judaism. And imagine, for those of you who watched or saw Fiddler on the Roof, right? That was a rebellion against that way of living. It happened during the national, what I call the national age. That is that what was happening around the Jews was the unification of Italy, unification of Germany, the nations of Austria, Hungary looking for self-determination. And Jews were living that. There was the doors of the ghettos were being opened. Jews were starting to go to universities, were influenced by the discussions around them. And they saw that nations and the right to self-determination was central at that time. And young Jews were saying, they had both an attraction and repulsion to what's going on. So that first thing is, when those nations were being built, A lot of Jews were told and felt, you don't belong with us. You're not part of us. And at the same time, they say, well, we're Jewish, we're a nation, we have a history, we have a culture, we have a personality, we even have a language. So why, if it's good for the Germans, it's good for the Italians, the Hungarians want that, the Czechs want it, you have all those movements going, said, well, if it's good for the goose, it's good for the gander as well. If those nations are building themselves and looking for self-determination, why aren't we doing that? And would not that solve the problem of anti-Semitism? Yes?
If the Jews are so tied emotionally to their country, why until 100 years ago were they spread around the world?
Well, so Jews were expelled in 1970. So let me just to go back a bit. Roman Empire, rebellion, destruction of the temple, 70 CE, lots of Jews are expulsed, diaspora starting to form, 135 CE, another rebellion under a leader by the name of Bar Kokhba, Jews are expelled, lots of people killed, and there were no place for them to go. And they started to go wherever they were accepted. They were looking for opportunities. Sometimes they were exposed. They were exposed many times from Britain or from France, and sometimes they were simply looking for a place that would accept them. But they could not go back to, let's call it modern, to Israel or the Middle East, because there was no place for them. There was no acceptation. They started to, move and go where, again, they were accepted. It's only in the modern age that you had that mix of reclamation of the letting go of that the religion and the emphasis put more on the national part of Jewishness, and the idea that a people to survive and to thrive needs to have a land that it controls. And Jews said, well, our land is actually where we came from. Our ancestral land is in the Middle East, isn't that what is now modern Israel, and we need to go back there. So you had that, first of all, that ideological debate over the nations, and then you had that the second prong I was talking about is modern anti-Semitism. You had thinkers that changed the nature of anti-Semitism. Whereas before it was religious anti-Semitism, so some people call it anti-Judaism, that is that the problem is the Jewish religion. If you convert into Christianity, then you become accepted. And you had intellectuals that said, lots, especially in Germany, that converted to Christianity and they saw it as the entrance ticket into European civilization. But some people said, well, even if a Jew converts to Judaism, to Christianity, I'm sorry, this person is still a Jew. So you had intellectual anti-Semitism, you had political anti-Semitism. This is Austro-Hungary. You had the Dreyfus Affair. So the Dreyfus Affairs is an important part of Jewish history and Zionist history. France is the nation of the Enlightenment. France is the place that sees itself as the land of rights and freedom. Since 1789, the Declaration of Human Rights, the separation of church and state, France sees itself as a civilization that will accept differences. And then you have a colonel in the French army called Alfred Dreyfus. And Dreyfus is a totally assimilated Jew. And there is the French find out that there's a spy in the higher ranks of their army. We're talking here turn of the 19th to 20th century. And you will recall that in 1870, there was a big war between Germany and France. That's when Germany was united. And chunks of France, Alsace and Lorraine, were taken by Germany. And there was high tension between the French and the Germans. And the two thought that there was going to be conflicts again between the two of them. And in fact, if you look at history, if you take a step back, 1870 is could be called the first Franco-German War, the First World War, the second one, and the third war being the Second World War. So it was always that battle for dominance in Europe between France and Germany. So so you have that context. Dreyfus is accused of being the leak, the spy. And people say, well, it's because he's a Jew. And Jews don't care about the countries they're in. So it turns into a huge debate in France. And there's a journalist there in France seeing that and seeing in Paris and hearing death to the Jews. And that journalist is thinking, how could it be that in France, the country of human rights, you could hear death to the Jews at this time? And this journalist has a name. His name is Theodor Herzl. So he said, if in a country like France, we Jews are not accepted, what's the point? So the solution to the Jewish problem is creating a Jewish state. And he goes into his room and writes this book, The Jewish State. Anti-Semitism is not only intellectual, it's not only political. In Kishinev, which is in Russia in 1903, there was a big pogrom, and the national Jewish poet, Bialik, wrote a fascinating poem called The City of Slaughter. And basically saying, talks about anti-Semitism, but he says, where were Jewish men? Your wives are being raped. Your daughters are being killed. Your sons are being killed. And where are the descendants of the Maccabees? And he fires up an entire generation of young Jews saying, no, we won't be victims anymore. We won't count on protection of the others. We're going to stand up for ourselves. We're going to create a society, we're going to build a country that we will not be the subjects of history, but we're going to participate in history. Our history will not be written by somebody else, we will write our own history. We will take matters into our own hands. And then from then on, Zionism grows and grows, especially in Eastern Europe. In Western Europe, Jews are not so sure. They're fairly well despite anti-Semitism, they're growing, they can send their kids to school, they're becoming more affluent, and they're saying, well, maybe not for us, but for our cousins back in Poland or in Eastern Europe and the Pale of Settlement, that would be a good idea. In brief, Zionism is born, and I'll answer you, with the confluence of two major things, Jewish nationalism and anti-Semitism. And those two elements created the growth of Zionism. So basic important dates in Zionist history, 1897, first Zionist Congress. So Theodor Herzl, going back to this guy who was a journalist and decides to write that piece, The Jewish State, start this thing. And people look at him and say, you're crazy. You're the correspondent for one of the most prestigious German language newspapers in Paris. You're a playwright. Your culture. You have talent. You have influence. Why would you do this? Why would you write that thing and put yourself in that position? People will look at you and you're crazy. And Theodor Herzl doesn't listen to them. He said, you know what? We're going to build something. We're going to build a movement. And he starts inviting people across Europe and North America, saying, we're going to have a Congress, and we're going to put those ideas into something concrete. So he starts building, in 1897, the Zionist movement. And he asked people, you know, if you come to the Congress, you have to dress properly. Not people dressed in rags. You're coming to the Congress, you have to wear a tie, you have to be serious, because we want to show that we Jews know how to do things. It was a bit of a snob, but he wanted to show that Jews in that movement were something serious. And in fact, after that that first Congress, he writes in his journal, he says, people will look at me as the founder of a new country. Maybe not in 5 years, but certainly in 50 years, this dream of mine will have been realized. And if somebody would have thought, if somebody would have read his journals in 1897, they would have said, what? There's no, it's just new, there's nothing really built, and you think that in 50 years, there'll be a country, a Jewish country someplace in the Middle East? And if you do 1897 plus 50, you go to 1947, and that is the day, November 29th, 1947, the UN voted for partitioning the land between an Arab state and a Jewish state. So this guy, who people thought was crazy, was in fact right in his 50 years, I think. 20 years later, after the first Zionist Congress, something important happens. First World War, there's a battle, you know, France, England, and Turkey, or the Ottoman Empire, France, England, and Russia against Germany, Austro-Hungary, and the Ottoman Empire, and Britain takes control of the Middle East. And was wondering a bit what to do. And for different political reasons, the government, Lord Balfour, who is the foreign affairs minister, writes to an important Jew in the British Jewish community and writes a letter in which he says, His Majesty's government view with favor the establishment in Palestine of a national home for the Jewish people. So 20 years after the first Zionist Congress, you have the major world power at the time, Britain, that gives its stamp of approval on the Zionist movement. And a few years later, the League of Nations, which is the organization that preceded the UN, gives its stamp of approval to the Balfour Declaration and gives the that piece of land under the mandate of the British. There were different pressures. First of all, there was in the higher-ups of the British government the idea that it was time for the Jewish cause was the right one. I'm not saying it was true or not. I'm saying there was that feeling that it was right. Two, there was a lot of Jewish refugees from the pogroms before, and a lot of British knew that the Jewish situation, especially in Eastern Europe, was not easy. Three, there was a desire by the British to have the Jewish, it's kind of anti-Semitism, but reverse. They thought that the Jewish influence in the U.S. was important, that it would help bring the U.S. into the war. So there was all of that going on at the same time. Yes?
How did this Balfour declaration fit within World War I? Because it seems to be, Europeans were preoccupied with it.
They were preoccupied, but they were thinking already about the post-World War. They were already making plans of carving up the Ottoman Empire, especially the French and the British. So you always have people during a war that will try to take things a bit further. So this is the British mandate. So the League of Nations says to Britain, "You're going to manage this piece of land." And this Syria is under French influence. Egypt is semi-independent, and the European powers, as per European colonialist ideas, we're going to carve up and we're going to do whatever we want. And whenever you see straight lines in their country, you know that those lines were drawn by somebody in one office that's totally disconnected from reality. And this is the British mandate, according, and this, the Balfour Declaration was supposed to apply to all of this. Right? The Jewish homeland, at the beginning, at least Jews thought that was going to apply there. The British had other ideas. Yes, sir, at the back.
Where's modern Israel on that map that you've got there?
Modern Israel, well, okay, let me, modern Israel and the Palestinian territories, the liberated territories, the occupied territories, call it whatever you want, because I don't want to make a judgment, is this in blue. Okay. 1922, Colonial Secretary is Winston Churchill. He goes there and says, well, you know what? We're going to move things a bit. And he partitions the British mandate under two different things. And he puts on the throne of Transjordan, a guy that the British had promised sovereignty over the holy places of Islam. And from the Hashemite, the families was the Hashemite. So I said, well, you know, we gave Arabia to the Saudi family, that's the name, and we're going to put a Hashemite king here. We're going to give him a piece of country, and actually they put another Hashemite on the throne of Iraq. So the Jews see this and say, well, that's not exactly what you promised us. You know, we thought it was going to be much bigger, but fine. So this is the new, so this is Transjordan, and this is Palestine, according to British parlance. So 1922. This is 80% of the British mandate. This is 20% of the British mandate. So, let me go back a bit. So, in this place, there are Jews and there are Arabs. And nationalism is developing. There's Jewish nationalism. They're building a society. But there are Arabs there. They had a society as well. And you're starting to see a clash of nationalism. You're starting to see two people who saw themselves as indigenous to this piece of land saying, well, this piece of land belongs to me. No, it belongs to me. And you start to see that. So British see that, and they're starting to see the tensions, and they realize the tensions. And they're saying, okay, well, that can't last. We have to do something about it. And the Jews are putting pressure. And we see the rise of the Nazi movement in Europe. And Jews want to get out of Europe. They see the storm coming. They're looking for places to go. But countries around the world don't want to accept Jews. And Jews want to come here. The Arab population said, no, don't want more Jews here. And you see the tension rising and rising. And the British decide to appoint a commission headed by a named Guy Peel and say, please find a solution to that conflict, because we need to solve this, because we know there's a war coming. Hitler is saying it, he's building his army, and we have to fix this. And they come up with this plan. It's called the Peel Partition Plan, where you see the country is divided in three. The blue being would be given to the Jews. This would be given to the Arabs. And Jerusalem and a link to the port of Jaffa would be internationalized. 1937. Okay, again, put in perspective, Hitler's in power. The persecutions are real. Jews look at what's happening and said, okay, we have to save what we can. So yes, we're going to take this. This is tiny. But we need this. We need to have a place where Jews can go. So yes, we're going to take it. Arab leadership says, no way. It's not going to happen. They refuse the partition plan of 1937. And then what happens? The war starts. So this is shelved, not going anywhere. In Second World War, 6 million Jews died. Jews had nowhere to go. And this is important. For Europeans, nation state means death, means war, means nationalism is death and war. And you have, starting in Europe, the beginning of, we have to create a united Europe that will be, that will bring nation states together, that will transcend this idea that each nation has to have its own state. But the Jews have exactly the opposite idea. For them, not having a state, not having a place that would welcome Jews, means death, means destruction. And Jews came out of the Second World War saying, countries closed their doors to us, including Canada. Remember, the none is too many. Remember St. Louis. Jews had nowhere to go, and they came out of Second World War saying, we need a place. We need a refuge. There's no way around it, because this time we were almost annihilated, and next time it's going to be finished. A third of the population of Jews were destroyed. So this idea of the importance of a Jewish state took even more importance. However, it is not true to say that Israel was born out of the Holocaust. Because already before the Second World War, there was already functioning Jewish society in Mandatory Palestine. They had schools. They had unions. They had a democracy that was working. They revived the Hebrew language, which was unheard of. It would be like today reviving Latin. The only people who could speak Hebrew were the rabbis and the students who would study in yeshiva. Hebrew was a dead language, but for going to synagogue. And when people started to want to revive the Jewish the Hebrew as a Jewish language, people said, it's impossible. How do you buy a train ticket in Hebrew? Whereas Hebrew was frozen in time. And it, and they decided, there was a name by a guy by the name of Eliezer ben I forget his name now because I went to bed too early, too late last night. Ben Yehuda. Eliezer ben Yehuda, who recreated a language. So you had an already functioning society. You had the basis of a country already in place. So, Britain was in charge, remember, but after the Second World War, Britain is exhausted. Britain is tired. And Britain can't manage Mandatory Palestine because there's a brewing civil war going on. And what it says, it said, okay, you know what? We'll give it to the UN. Let's the UN solve that issue. And the UN sends a committee to study the problem and say, like the Peel Commission 10 years earlier, the solution is two states, an Arab state and a Jewish state. And that is exactly the words that are used, an Arab state and a Jewish state. And they propose this, in blue being the Jewish part, the red being the Arab part, and Jerusalem and Bethlehem to be internationalized. Vote is taken in November 1947 at the UN. The vote passes. Jews are dancing in the streets. But the Arabs say, no, we're not going to accept this. And now starts a race to see how can we make sure that for the Jews that the Jewish state is born, and on the Arab side, how do we make sure that the Jewish state is not born? So now groups start getting ready for a war that everybody knows is coming. People know that as soon as the British leave, it's going to be war. Imagine this. So the British are about to go, and the Jews have to decide what are they going to do. And there's pressure on them to say, don't declare independence. It's the wrong thing to do. And if you do, you're not armed enough, you're gonna die. And we're talking here 2 years after the Holocaust, right? 2 years after the Second World War. And there's pressure, and some members of the American government are putting pressure. So the Jews, the Jewish leadership knows that the decision is coming. Ben-Gurion sends his foreign affairs minister to Washington to see where the Americans stand. And they voted for petition. You see the Moshe Sharet, who is the foreign affairs minister, comes into Washington to judge where the Americans want. And he goes to Washington, and the Secretary of State for Truman is George Marshall. Moshe Sharet comes into his office, and Marshall says, don't sit down. Just so tell you, Ben-Gurion, that declare independence is the wrong thing to do. Wow. So Sharet said, okay. Goes back to Jerusalem and goes and sees Ben-Gurion and says, you know, David, the Americans tell us not to declare independence. And Ben-Gurion says, don't tell anyone this. So they're sitting around the table after that. One of the first things that Sharet says is, well, the Americans don't want us to declare independence. So people are like, the government, the quasi-government, it's not a country yet, but they have, like, as I said, the institutions are debating, and people are wondering, because is it going to be dangerous? Are we going to disappear? And there's a whole debate around the table. And Ben-Gurion sees it's not necessarily going his way. So he says, okay, we'll take a break. And he takes people one by one and convinces his colleagues to declare independence. One of them will say, Ben-Gurion put on our head the gun of history. He put on our head the gun of history. Because Ben-Gurion said, if we don't do it now, we will never have the chance to realize the dream that's 2,000 years old. May 15, 1948, the British leave, and there's a decision to declare independence, and there's a decision, so the State of Israel is declared, and there's a war. The War of Independence, seen by the Palestinians as the Nakba, the catastrophe. Because you see the birth of a country and the non-birth of another one. And the parts that were supposed to be given to, let me go with this, because forget the Six-Day War now for now, but this part and this part were not conquered by the Jewish forces, but this was taken over by Transjordan, that became Jordan. And Gaza was taken over by Egypt. And there was no desire by Egypt to let Palestinian self-determination happen. And there was no desire by Jordan to let a Palestinian country to be born. So what you saw in 1948 and during the War of Independence or the Nakba, you saw basically the Jews winning, the Palestinian losing, and the Palestinian being screwed by their neighbors. So is it a catastrophe for the Palestinians? Absolutely. So they lost. 1947 to 1967, and I'll go very quickly here. Israel is building. They have 800,000 Jewish refugees. I'm talking Palestinian refugees. 800 to 850,000 Jewish refugees leaving Muslim and Arab lands. Because there's a backlash to the creation of the State of Israel. Jews are kicked out from Iraq, are kicked out from many of the Middle Eastern countries. So you basically have a transfer of population. You have Arab that leave what is Israel proper, Are they expulsed? Are they kicked out? Do they leave out of their own accord? There's differences of opinion. To me, the best person who wrote about it is Benny Morris, Israeli historian, worth reading. But there's a transferred population, and you have thousands and thousands and thousands of Jewish refugees coming to Israel proper. 1967, Six-Day War, very quickly. Egypt closes the Gulf of Tehran here. I call here it Gulf of Eilat, but the international term is Gulf of Tehran. And there's a preemptive war by Israel that conquers the Sinai, conquers the West Bank, and conquers the Golan Heights. So this, which was under Jordan, now is under Israeli control. And when we talk about liberated territories, if you're a right-wing Israeli, if you're talking about occupied territory, if you're Palestinian or an international community, this is what we're talking about. So, after the war in 1967, Jews say, okay, we're ready to negotiate, come to the table, and we're negotiate land for peace, right? I'm going to give back the land, but you're going to recognize me, and we're going to have peace. And the Arab League in Khartoum, in a meeting, says, no peace with Israel, no recognition of Israel, no negotiations with Israel. Remember what I was telling you about the history that Jews remember and how important? So the Jews are saying, okay, so in 1937, there was a proposition to have a two-state solution, and we said yes, the Arabs said no. 1947, there was a proposition to have a two-state solution under the UN partition plan. The Jews said yes, the Arabs say no. 1967, even after we kicked the tuchus, even though we beat the Arab armies, we're willing to sue to have a land for peace agreement, the Arabs say no. So in the Israeli mentality, they tried and tried and tried, and people said no. Again, I'm not putting judgment. Were the Arabs right to say yes, to say no? I'm leaving that out for now. But from the Jewish perspective, that's the narrative. 1979, land for peace. Jews go and retreat from every square centimeter of the Sinai that they had conquered from Egypt. And there's a peace agreement with Egypt at Camp David, peace agreement that still stands. So land for peace is possible. 1987, first Intifada. So there was the uprising against the Jewish or Israeli occupation. And out of that Intifada came in 1993, the Oslo Accord. 2000, Camp David negotiations. According to Bill Clinton, who tried to have the two parties sign the deal, the people who ultimately said no are the Palestinians. And when Arafat, Clinton was leaving, when Arafat called Clinton, and Arafat, by the way, was the foreign leader that was welcomed the most often in the Oval Office under Clinton, said, Mr. President, you're a great man. Clinton said, no, I'm not. I'm a failure, and you made me one. 2000 and 2004, second Intifada, and that created, and we still see the results of that, is the destruction of the peace camp in Israel. People who were told there's a possibility of a deal, we just have to make the necessary sacrifices to reach that deal. There's a will. We can do it. It's going to be difficult, but we can do it. When they saw the Intifada, when their buses were blown up, when you go to a cafe and you don't know if there's going to be a bomb under the table, if somebody's going to walk in with a suicide vest under their coat, it destroyed for the Israelis the idea that there was a will on the other side. Were they right? Were they wrong? That's another thing for now. But this is what happened. 2008, there was another offer and another refusal. For Israel, a Palestinian state is both an existential necessity and an existential threat. What do I mean by that? Israelis don't want to occupy another people. They don't want to send their boys 3 years in the army between 18 and 21 and their girls 2 years in the army and do reserve duty a month until they're 40s. They don't want to do that. They know that it's not good for Israel, let alone the Palestinians. Nothing good can come out of an occupation. At the same time, though, when they're looking at the situation around them, they say, well, we evacuated South Lebanon in 2000, and who took control of the area that we control at the time? It's Hezbollah, an Islamist group bent on destroying Israel. And when they pulled out of Gaza in 2005, shortly thereafter, who took control? Hamas. And they're thinking, well, if we were to evacuate the West Bank, which is at the border with, you know, Jerusalem is on that border, so you would have the border, quote unquote, would be a few hundred meters from Israel's parliament, from Israel's prime minister's office. It would be 8 kilometers from the only international airport in Israel, the Ben Gurion Airport. So is it worth it? So you're in a situation where Mr. Madam Israeli, the centrist, the non-ideological Israeli, thinks, yeah, Palestinian state and the end of occupation is a good idea because we don't want to send our kids there and it's not good. At the same time, if we leave now, probably we are under existential threat and our country could disappear. For the Palestinians, the benefits of peace seem further and further away. And when you go there, and I was telling somebody, I don't know who, I've been there 36 times, and every time I go, I make time to go into the Palestinian territories. There's no light. And some people say, well, we were better off before. So it's bizarre because they haven't seen the benefits of the peace. So there's resentment being created as well. And what you also see is that the Israel-Palestinian issue is becoming less and less central. You see what's going on in, Lebanon's not working well. They finally formed a government after months and months of problems. You see what's going on in, of course, Iraq and Syria. Egypt had coup d'etat, then you have a dictator that's there. Jordan is afloat because of international support. And by the way, that includes Israel's support. Security-wise, Jordan is dependent also on Israel. So for good and for bad, the Israel-Palestinian issue for that region is not as central as it used to be. Again, there's good things coming for this and bad things coming from that. Anti-Zionism and anti-Semitism. So there's always that question, is opposition to the state of Israel anti-Semitism? And some people say, well, you know, every time we're accused, every time we say Israel did something wrong, we're accused of being anti-Semites. And that's BS. I don't think that's the case. I think that Tom Friedman said it best when he says that criticizing Israel is not anti-Semitic and saying so is vile, but singling out Israel for opprobrium and international sanction out of all proportion of any other party in the Middle East is anti-Semitic and not saying so is dishonest. Basically, what I think, where you see the difference is, if there's a denial of the Jewish people's right to self-determination, if there's a demonization of Israel and there's a double standard applied to a situation, when you have that double standard, you can question if the criticism of Israel, like of criticism of any other country, has crossed the line into something that's darker and not as benevolent, I'll say that way. People, thank you very much for your attention. It was fun to be here.
Ishar, thank you very much. I told you he'd be good.
Yes.
Thank you so much for coming. I understand you're willing to make your slides, share your slides.
Yeah.
So you can send them to me, and I will send them to you. And I'll also send you his, if it's okay, his email.
Absolutely.
So if you have follow-up questions, you can do it that way.
Absolutely.
So thank you very much. Next week, we're going to delve into this question of the Palestinians.